funerals. They didn't go to tell nobody what had happened to them. They just went and preached. Because radical gratitude is expressed in radical ways. Let me real quick help you, because I don't want to miss Fanny and miss her catfish. Because I don't want her to remember the last thing is that Deacon Owens ate her fish. Is a concept that is challenging to exhibit all the time. What am I saying? I love my company, meaning being with the Lord, but I don't always love my circumstances. I love being in the presence of God. I love the Holy Spirit being in me and being with me. I love God, Jehovah, God, Yahweh, God, Elohim, God. I love the fact that I am connected and in the company of God at all times, at all places, but sometimes I don't love my circumstances. I don't love what I'm going through. I don't love how some folks approach me. I don't love how my body feels sometimes. I don't love. So when you tell me to be cheerful all the time. When you tell me to give thanks all the time, sometimes it's difficult to display. I know some of y'all are always bubbling, but I don't always get to drink what you drink. If you walk around with a little private canister, you can say bubbly. A little private flask. And every time we look around, Deacon Owens got his flask. And he's feeling good. Brown's losing by 30, he's still chilling. At the Browns game, I want to sell alcohol. You can't stay with a losing team unless you're drunk.
Watch out, Pastor.
Got that reason for the game. I'm going to see if I can drink 15 beers this time. What's the score? Who cares? The whole concept of being grateful, being thankful all the time is more than emotion. Every single one of us experience some challenging days. Every single one of us go through some challenging circumstances. Every single one of us are sometimes in the midst of challenging company. Come on, some folks it's hard to be thankful for. I mean, come on now. I know we in church and y'all trying to do the old holy thing. There are some folks you'd rather not be around. So the first point is, it is a concept that is sometimes challenging to display. The first point. Second point. It's a concept that needs comprehension. You got to understand what the scripture says. It says right here, in all things, not for all things.
Right.
And some of y'all have prepositional problems. You didn't do good in English. You struggle with prepositions. So you put the ends and the does and the ofs in the wrong places. He says, in all things, not for all things. See, you need some comprehension. God does not require you to be grateful or thankful for anxiety. He says be thankful in anxiety.
Yes, yes.
He doesn't say be thankful for burdens. He says be thankful in your burdens. He doesn't say be thankful for cancer. He says learn to be thankful in cancer. He doesn't say be thankful for disease, but be thankful in. Y'all ain't getting it yet.
Yes, yes, yes.
He doesn't say be thankful for your enemies. Be thankful in the presence of your enemies. He doesn't say be thankful for your failures. Be thankful in the face of your failures.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir. You preach. You preach.
You got to understand the curse. God is not requiring something that is humanly impossible.
Wow.
Tell your neighbor, it's doable.
It's doable.
Oh, you can do this thing. You can have peace in the face of confusion. You can have joy in the face of sorrow. You can shout in the face of sadness. You can feel well in the face of ill health. You can be rich when you're still poor.
Yeah, yeah.
You can have love even when folks give you hate. Just got to understand the concept. Got to understand the concept. Once you understand the concept, the application becomes easy.
Right, right.
Once you understand what God is expecting of God, because see, you got to understand, we talk about radical gratitude, which means that it's at the root. Well, the root of us being grateful is the fact that rooted inside of us is a grateful gene. You know, I talk all the time about the fruit of the Spirit, the 9 genetic traits transferred from spiritual rebirthing to every believer. The ability to be thankful, the ability to be joyful, the ability to have peace are all genetically transferred to the believer at his conversion. I don't know who tells y'all gotta keep going back to get stuff. Look, if I go back to William and Wanda Bunton and say, I want to get some stuff I didn't get at birth, like a different set of eyes, some different color hair, you know, since it's genetic, Mom, y'all got some other stuff I didn't get when I was born, and when I have my face slapped to the back of my head, y'all come fix it for me, because I know. And what I'm saying, well, if the natural birth gives me everything I'm going to ever be at birth, at conception, everything I am now was in me in my mama's belly. Everything I am. So when I'm born again, you think God is dumber than biology? If he made it the first time, you think he ain't gonna know how to do it the next time? So when we're born again spiritually, everything we're gonna become is already planted in us. Joy, peace, love, long-suffering, temperance, the whole 9 yards. You don't become a super saint because you run off somewhere and get a special anointing. Real quick, point one, concept challenging to exhibit.
Preach on.
Point two,
okay.
Concept that needs comprehension.
Comment.
You got to understand, God is saying, in all things, Why can I do it? Because he did all things. Last point. It's a concept that should ignite celebration. After comprehension. In other words, what am I saying? After you understand it, you ought to be able to shout. Let me look, because see, we only read verse 18, but the whole chapter kind of leads this way, you know, and we, there's some stuff in there that we could take the next hour or two to talk about, going to pray without ceasing, question out the spirit, all that kind of stuff. Okay, we can get doctrinal, we ain't got time for that. We're just talking about gratitude today. One of the reasons, though, but the whole chapter leads you to the place of being grateful, and helps you to understand how you can be radically grateful in the face of disturbing circumstances.
One,
right way back in, you know, beginning of the chapter, you know, it gives you that one of the reasons why you ought to be grateful no matter what is because you have an understanding of divine administration. Divine administration meaning God is in control. What am I saying? You can get excited no matter what's going down. Why? Because you know that in other words, you got, as a believer, we get inside information.
Yes.
You know how some of y'all like secret stuff anyway? Inside information means we should know something about divine administration. Divine administration means that the big boss is God, and the final word comes from God, and no matter what it looks like, God is still in control. Trump ain't running nothing. Young ain't running nothing. I mean, Pence ain't running nothing. Obama didn't run nothing. Putin ain't running nothing. ISIS ain't running nothing. Why? As a believer, I can be grateful for all things because I understand divine administration. God is in control. Verse 2 talks about Jesus returning. So there's another reason to be radically grateful is because I have some understanding of spiritual anticipation. Divine administration, spiritual anticipation. I'm always on tiptoes waiting for the second coming of Christ. I know that sooner or later this madness is going to be over because he's going to come back to rule and super rule his word. Some of y'all ain't got divine anticipation. See, that's why you can't be excited. Some of y'all can't stand anticipation. Because it's making you wait. Remember the old commercial with the ketchup? Anticipation. Anticipation is making you wait. A lot of us don't like waiting. That's why we don't say, I don't mind waiting with real fervor, because we lying. But spiritual anticipation lets me know that it doesn't matter what's happening, because if God said it, it's coming. If God said it, that settles it. It's going to happen. It's going to come to pass. It's just a matter of time. If I show some patience, so I can shout while I'm waiting. In fact, the longer he takes, the more shouts I can get in. One thing I used to talk about with Sister Julie, I said, Sister Julie, you always pick the long version of the praise songs, the praise dance. She said, but I like this song. So they have a 5-minute version. Sister Julie has the 10-minute version.
Okay.
And she danced every minute. And my thing is that if the Lord delays his coming, that means I got more time to practice my shout. Divine administration, spiritual anticipation. But then again, he says right here in verse 4, now this was cute. He talks about we shouldn't be upset because we're children of the light. So what he said is, I don't know why you ain't grateful or excited, because you should be a recipient of divine illumination. You've been exposed to the sun, S-O-N. And because you're exposed to the sun, not the S-U-N, the S-O-N, because you've been exposed to the sun, you should have sobriety of light.
Yes.
Because he talks about being sober in your life, meaning you should have some sobriety of life. You should have the ability to literally be sober in how you live.
Yes.
Some of y'all don't drive drunk, you live drunk. Just let me ask you, how you living with your drunk living self? I see how you make decisions because you're drunk. See why your marriage is because you're drunk. See why your job is because you're drunk. But if you've been exposed to the sun, there is a sobriety of light that comes with connection to Christ. There should be the light of salvation. Part of what makes me excited is the fact that he saved a wretched sinner like me. And so what happens, despite what I go through, I have a gratitude for the fact that he was willing to pick me up, turn me around, and place my feet on solid ground. The fact that he was willing to go to a cross and die for a sinner like me, go to a tomb and stay for a sinner like me, rise the third day morning to release a sinner like me, promise to come back for a sinner. Divine illumination. Last thing, and I'm out.
Okay.
Says you ought to be radically grateful because not only you understand divine mysteries, God is in control.
Right.
Sometimes we have to remember that. Sometimes when I'm flustered and all upset, it's like something, spirit taps me on the shoulder. So why are you tripping about that?
All right.
You ain't even running that. Church is doing this. God, Sabrina's doing this. Sabrina always be doing something, but Sabrina's doing this.
It's all of
God, the diaconate is doing this. God. Yeah, and sometimes he just tap me on the shoulder and says, you ain't running nothing.
God
is in control.
Yes.
But the last thing is when it gets down to verses 11 through 13, and it kind of deals with a concept of koinonia, which is the Greek word for fellowship. And it means, I tell folks, there's no ship like fellowship. You know, fellowship leads to friendship, leads to fellowship. You know, and what happens, you create a big happy ship. So what happens, we go on a spiritual cruise.
All right.
And we're high on Jesus. And what happens is he says that we should understand something about or be a participant of divine unification. We are literally working to be unified because we're stronger together than we can ever be apart. What makes us excited is the fact that we have somebody beside us that when we falter, they can prop us up. When we struggle, they can help us through the struggle. When we fall, they can give us a hand to pull us back up. I'm done. Radical gratitude is being able to say thank you. Even when it doesn't seem like there's anything to be thankful for.
Amen.
It's the ability to shout when all around you says, be silent. It's the ability to run when everybody else is walking. is the ability to rock in the choir when everybody else is standing stationary.
Yes.
It's the ability to say, hallelujah, Jesus. When everybody else is saying, hold up, Jesus. It's the ability to look up when everybody else is looking down. It's the ability to say, I got a feeling that everything is going to be all right. How can you say that, brother? Well, you know the old folks say, well, the Holy Ghost, he told me everything is going to be all right. I got a feeling that everything is gonna be alright. If you know it's really gonna be alright, lean over and tell somebody, oh, I got so much to thank God for. Oh, I got a reason to tell the Lord thank you. If you don't have a reason, whenever I tell you something that makes you think about it, your reason to tell the Lord thank you. As I move a little higher, I want you to stand on your feet and give God a praise offering. If you won't give up this morning, wave your hand and tell the Lord thank you. If you put clothes on your back, you tell the Lord, thank you, Lord. Oh, if you put food on your table, tell the Lord, Lord, I thank you. If you put food on the table, as I move a little higher, if there's anybody in this room that God has healed your body, tell the Lord, oh Lord, I thank you for healing my body. If the Lord has been there, if there's anybody here that God delivered you from your enemies, boy, raise your hand and tell the Lord, thank you, Lord, for protecting me. Oh, yeah. I'm going a little higher. Don't sit down here. But if you know God has been good to you, no, not just good, but good. Take your neighbor's hand and say, neighbor, the inside. How many of you are saved and you know? You made a way when my back was against the wall and it looked like it was all over. You made it was all over.